has to be about proactive engagement. So what else besides programming? So we're proposing really six key components of acceptance, dimensions, things to think about as you are, if you as an organization are really taking acceptance as your primary way of thinking about security management. Principles and mission, we've spoken a lot about this already today, humanitarian principles, but also other principles or values that guide and shape an organization's programming and mission. For some more developmentally focused organizations, it might be about do no harm. It might be about a rights-based approach to development. It might be about eliminating poverty. So being very clear on what your principles and your mission actually are. The key, though, is that organizations can't really, it's not enough to just state them. You have to demonstrate these principles in practice. And often that, as we've heard already today, it's the consistency both of interpretation, but also of implementation of these principles that gets often very tricky. Stakeholder and context analysis is a second component. Stakeholder analysis, we are thinking about in terms of identifying and analyzing the motives, the attitudes, capabilities, and relationships of actors who might wish to do you harm, who might wish to somehow influence your programs and your security. Contextual analysis is about the context in which you're working and the circumstances, but it's also about how your organizational values, mission, programming interact with that context. So who an organization serves and who might either directly or indirectly gain or lose from an organization's presence or activities. So this part of it, the context analysis, is also very much about knowing thyself, knowing your organization, but also how you, within your organization, internally, how staff members understand both the organization and its principles and values. So a lot of this has been, dovetails with what we've been speaking on already. Relationships and networks is our third component. It involves active outreach to a variety of constituencies. It's not, though, just about who benefits from programs. The perceptions of beneficiaries are obviously important, but it's also about those who are not benefiting. Do they understand why they might not be benefiting from a program? We heard earlier about the dilemma of working in the entire district as opposed to choosing several villages because MSF in that context didn't want to necessarily engage those questions. So that's part of analyzing your relationships and your networks, because in some cases that might be linked to security. Programming, again, I think there is very much a common misperception out there that acceptance is equal to good programming. It's not really just about that, though, for the reasons I mentioned earlier. Acceptance or positive perceptions are tied to good, effective, and responsive programming that meets the needs of a community, but this isn't enough. It has to be something more, maybe about trust, maybe about the relationships, how you actually deliver that programming. Negotiation for either formal or informal access with, everything from with the host, negotiation with the host government to negotiating at a checkpoint with men with guns. There's all sorts of skills and abilities that are associated with that. Communications is our last component, what we're calling key component, and it really is about the implicit and explicit messages that your organization is sending, but it's also about the being aware of what the media is saying about you, both international media as well as local media, whether or not they're connected to the organization. I know of one organization that was working, I believe it was in Haiti before the earthquake, and there was an incident with some peacekeepers, and this organization reported it, and it had direct security implications for their work in the country of the peacekeeper, which was halfway around the world. I think it was a Sri Lankan peacekeeper, and their organization then was targeted in Sri Lanka as a result of that. So it really is about monitoring for clues about how you're perceived in a variety of different ways. So, and this is where I guess our perception link comes in a little bit more clearly. We talk about cross-cutting components, and this is where staffing and image and perceptions really come in. These cross-cutting issues, they are cross-cutting in that they affect and are affected by the other components. So staffing really affects the other key components, how you know, who your staff are, how you program your relationships and your networks. Has to do with things like who's hired and who's fired, the skills and competencies of your staff, even the composition of your staff. Does it reflect the local context or does it differ? Do you have all Christian staff or mostly Christian staff in a Muslim area, and what does that do to your perceptions? Are your staff all from one region of a country rather than being, you know, regionally based? And how do you, it's not that you have to have, you know, staff from all regions, but just be aware of how that might, your staffing and what the composition of your staff is, how that might actually influence your security. Turnover can also be another issue, in part because of the transferability issue I identified before, that if one person in your staff or one member of an organization has really good relationships with belligerents or with local communities, and that person leaves, what does that do to your acceptance? Does that, you know, does it disappear? And then, so finally, image and perceptions as being affected by the other key components. And I think this is where some of what John just spoke about, the local and the global, the interactions, and it just is a very concrete example. After the cartoon was published that was seen to profane Muhammad, many Muslims interpreted it as profaning Muhammad, that was published in a Danish newspaper. It had ramifications for Christian Danish Western NGOs in a lot of Muslim contexts. So that's an example of a kind of global phenomenon that has a local impact. So really, it's not enough to just rely on impressions or speculations about how you're perceived. You really have to test these out. So just, I guess, to conclude, really that is it, that perceptions can be more more general, but acceptance, as we're talking about it, is really linked to security. What are the security implications of an of perceptions and how you are perceived? And I think in the face of all the challenges that are confronting humanitarian and other aid organizations, a better understanding of how they are perceived and why is really imperative. Thanks.
Other questions? Did your research also dig down further into the motivations for the attacks or targeting of aid workers and how your three categories of what was, what I think was protection, acceptance,
and deterrence.
And deterrence. And how you would strategize tactically in terms of which one would become the priority depending on what the motivation was for the attack.
Yeah, and I think that is something we aren't doing. I mean, that's part of our motivation, I think, for looking into this more more deeply. I mean, causes of incidents are sometimes, but not always, linked to perceptions. I mean, it might be linked to, say, behavior of a staff person, but it also could be linked to, you know, something. It could be a random event or a crime that doesn't necessarily mean it was targeted at an organization. So we're not necessarily in this project looking into acceptance or protection and deterrence. We're really focusing on acceptance with a goal to trying to figure out under what context, like when do you know that you're, how do you know you're doing it? How do you know you have it? And if you think you have it, is it working? So that's kind of where we're going to be. Hopefully, we'll be further along in answering those questions after we do the field testing in April. And, you know, hopefully we'll be working on some reporting and publishing of our results in the summer and early fall. Find the mic.
Like a rat in a maze. So I'm wondering if there's some correlation between trust and acceptance, and given that you're talking about this, the idea that, acceptance could be transferable, and it reminded me of Annette Baer's work on trust, where she talks about trust in office as opposed to trust in individuals, and then talks about the transferability to the individual who takes the office, even though they themselves may not have given any reason to be trustworthy. So I wondered if acceptance would take on similar sorts of characteristics.
Yeah, and at the moment we don't know. We're speculating that that might be the case. My own kind of perspective on that is organizations that have, and I, and this is kind of a gut level reaction, that organizations that have stronger kind of cultures, and that, and organizations for which the principles and mission are very, very clear, that trust, that acceptance might be more transferable because it's gained on behalf of the organization. But I don't, you know, I don't really have any evidence for that. That would just be speculation on my part. But that's, you know, I don't think we're going to be able to answer all of those questions that arise, but it's certainly, you know, some things that we're looking into.
Thanks.
Thanks.
You can leave it there now.